Good afternoon. My name is K. Ramesh Babu. I am working as Associate Professor at St. Martin's Engineering College. Okay, I am teaching the subject of Engineering Physics for the students of Civil and Mechanical in this academic year. So today, I want to explain the construction and working of a device, helium neon laser. Earlier, I told about the principle of a laser and I told about the ruby laser also. So today, I will explain the second type of laser, that is helium neon laser. Remember that helium neon laser is an example of gas laser. In this laser, the neon atoms are active centers. That means the neon atoms actually emit laser beam. So then we call the neon atoms as active centers. Now we look at the construction of this particular laser. In this laser, we consider a specially designed discharge tube. So the specially designed discharge tube is something like this. And here we observe that the discharge tube is fitted with two electrodes. So it is a specially designed discharge tube and it is fitted with two electrodes. Then the end faces of this discharge tube, they are made at a particular angle. That angle is called as Brewster's angle. And this surfaces, the end surfaces, they are called as Brewster's window. That means, because of this Brewster's window's arrangement, we get a polarized laser beam from this device. So that is about the discharge tube construction. Now this discharge tube is placed between two reflecting mirrors. So this is the left side reflecting mirror. This is the right side reflecting mirror. Now this discharge tube is filled with helium and neon gases. This discharge tube is filled with helium and neon gases in the ratio of 10:1. That means 10 parts are helium atoms and only one part is neon atoms. So that is about the construction details of this particular device. Now we look at the working of this device. The working of this device we can understand with the help of energy level diagrams. Here I showed the energy levels of helium atoms and also I showed the energy levels of neon atoms. The helium atoms are identified by three energy levels. I am denoting these three energy levels are as F1, F2, F3. These are the allowed energy levels of helium atoms. And in the same interval of F1 to F3, in that interval, the neon atoms will have 6 energy levels. So the 6 energy levels are E1, E2, E3, E4, E5, E6. These are the 6 energy levels corresponding to the neon atoms. Now, if you connect a high tension power supply between the two electrodes, there occurs electrical discharge between one electrode to the other electrode. That means there occurs flow of electrons from one electrode to the other electrode. That is called electrical discharge. And this electrical discharge, it will excite the lighter helium atoms to the higher levels. And because of that excitation, some helium atoms are excited to F2 level and some helium atoms are excited to F3 level. In this manner, we excite the helium atoms to the excited levels F2 and F3, then these excited helium atoms, they transfer their energy to the neon atoms. Because there are a large number of helium atoms which are surrounding the neon atoms and there occurs transfer of energy from helium atoms to the neon atoms. That transfer takes place because of the collisions between helium atoms and neon atoms. So there occurs collisions between helium atoms and neon atoms. Because of the result of these collisions, some neon atoms are excited to E4 level and some neon atoms are excited to E6 level. Here, this E4 level and F2 level are at the same height and E6 level and F3 level are at the same height. Because of that, some neon atoms are directly excited to E4 level, some neon atoms are excited to the E6 levels. And after transferring energy, the helium atoms, they return to the ground level, but we find there are some neon atoms in E4 level and there are some neon atoms in E6 level. Then immediately we find population inversion between E6 level and E5 level, and we find population inversion between E6 and E3 level, and we find population inversion between E4 and E3 level. And because of this population inversion conditions, there occurs three laser transitions. The first laser transition takes place between E6 level and E5 level, and that laser transition will take place at the wavelength of 3.39 micrometers. And remember that this 3.39 micrometers lies in infrared region. Then, because of the laser transition between E6 and E3 level, there occurs laser emission at a wavelength of 6328 angstroms. And because of this laser transition between E4 and E3 level, there occurs laser emission at a wavelength of 1.15 micrometers. Again, this 1.15 micrometers lies in the infrared region. But what about this 6328 angstroms? This 6328 angstroms, it is the wavelength of red color, and this will lie in the visible region. So like this, we get three laser transitions and three laser beams will come out from the medium. But by using some optical method, we can eliminate this infrared radiation, and finally we get only one laser beam at a wavelength of 6328 angstroms. Now, after emitting laser beams, the neon atoms reaching E3 level and E5 level, they fall back to E2 level through non-radiative transition. They fall back to E2 level through non-radiative transition. But the problem with this laser is, here E2 level is also a metastable state. That means the neon atoms reaching E2 level, they may stay for a longer time in this level. So to avoid that, what we do is, we will take the discharge tube as narrow as possible. If you take this discharge tube as narrow as possible, what happens is, the neon atoms reaching E2 level, they collide with walls of the discharge tube. And because of that collisions, the neon atoms reaching E2 level, they fall back to E1 level. In that manner, the neon atoms, after emitting laser beam, they return to the ground level E1. And here, this process is continuous. What do we mean by continuous? The helium atoms are continuously excited to the higher level and transfer their energy to the neon atoms, and they return to the ground level. And at the same time, the neon atoms are excited to higher levels and they cause laser emission, and they also return to the ground level. So this process of emitting laser beam is a continuous process. And because of this continuous laser beam emission, we say that the helium neon laser is operated in CW mode. CW mode means it is operated in continuous wave mode. So that is about the working of this particular laser. Now, there are some advantages of this laser over the ruby laser. In case of ruby laser, we are getting a pulsed laser beam. But in case of helium neon laser, we are getting a continuous laser beam. So that is one advantage. And in case of ruby laser, to achieve population inversion, we have to supply a large amount of energy to the ruby crystal. But here, a large amount of energy is not required. By applying a small amount of energy only, we achieve the population inversion condition. And after getting population inversion condition, we know that a single spontaneously emitted photon will begin the stimulated emission, and the stimulated emission process are multiplied, and finally we will get a continuous laser beam from the helium neon laser. So like that, we can talk about the working of this particular helium neon laser. And only there is one disadvantage with this laser. The disadvantage is like this: the power output of this helium neon laser is only in the order of few milliwatts. But the ruby laser will have a high amount of power output, but helium neon laser will have a small amount of power output, that will be in the order of milliwatts. So that is about the disadvantage of this particular helium neon laser. Okay. Now we'll see the applications of this particular laser. And helium neon laser is used in the 3D photography, that is to produce a 3D photograph, we use helium neon laser, and to view the that 3D photograph also, we use the helium neon laser. So that is one application of this helium neon laser, and it is used for sensing applications. So remote sensing can be achieved by using the helium neon laser. So these are some applications of this helium neon laser. Now, I will tell the applications of laser. So, we talk about the applications of any type of laser. We know that laser has special characteristics like high intensity and high monochromaticity and high coherence and high directionality. Because of these special characteristics, laser is used in almost in every field. I will tell the fields and the use of laser in that field. First of all, I will take the field of communications. In communications, we use laser to have communications between earth and satellites, and we can use to have communications like telecommunication system. So in telecommunication system, actually we use fibers, but in fibers we use the light source like laser to carry the data. So like that we use the laser in the field of communications. Then I will tell about the application in the field of computers. In the field of computers, we use laser in local area network. Okay, in LAN, that is local area network, we use laser beam to transfer the data from the memory source of one computer to the memory source of other computer. So that is one application in the field of computers. Then to store the data and to record the data, store the data, and to read the data. To store and read data in CD-ROMs. Okay, that is also an application of laser in the field of computers. Then we look at the field of industry. In industry, we use laser beam to blast holes in hard materials like diamonds and hard steel. So in that hard materials we can blast holes using laser beam. Then the laser beam is used for cutting, drilling and welding purposes. Okay, the laser beam also can be used for cutting, drilling, welding purposes. So these are some industry applications. Then in scientific field, we use laser to accelerate chemical reactions and in the field called as Raman spectroscopy. and to produce three-dimensional photographs also we use laser beam. So these are some scientific field applications. Then we look at the another field, that is military. In military field, what type of applications we can have? Let us see now. In military, we use laser beam to detect the enemy target, to detect enemy target. That is one application. That means the laser beam bounced off enemy target is studied, analyzed, and we can understand where is the target like that. So that is one application, and we use the laser beam as death rays. That means laser beam is also used for the purpose of destruction. So these are some applications in the field of military. And finally, we look at the field of medical field. In medical field, what type of applications we have? Let us see now. In medical field, we use laser beam for eye treatment. For eye treatment, we use laser beam. For microsurgeries, we use laser beam. For microsurgeries, and for the treatment of cancer, for these purposes we use laser beam in the field of medical. So like this, we can have almost in every field we have laser applications. So that is what I want to say. Okay, thank you.